designed and is CNC produced. So we were developing this more and more. A2 cockpits. Here you see another key feature, which is actually embedding things in the context, not having just one function, but trying to have multiple functions at the same time, being an acoustic barrier and a car showroom at the same time. Key features, well, you see much of the same, so this stretches 2 decades from the first building to this building. You see many consistent feature lines, actually. It's this subtlety, this elasticity of the lines, but you see also all the other key features are mentioned. And now we added this other potential to it, that it can merge perfectly with heritage. Building in Abu Dhabi, called the Liwa Tower, named after the Liwa Desert, actually, the Liwa Oasis, sorry, near the empty quarter, because that's where the client came from, and it made him think of that desert. We didn't intentionally design it, like reminiscent of the elegant lines of the dunes formed by the wind. Another shared characteristic of our work, and I always, it's always our work, because it's Ilona and myself running the studio. It's, and you will see art projects as well, is this notion of the swarm. So when I talk about building components, one building, one detail, this single detail communicates with its immediate neighbor. That's basically the setting. And only that. So this is what I want to show today. I think if we count 12 projects, 12 small projects, so not at all at the same scale of the previous ones, much smaller projects, but it's our way, so to say, to actually work here, to be a maker. To be a maker, and not only of our own work, but also be co-makers of student work. So these are student paintings. I show more of student work, actually. What I asked the students here to do a collective painting. So as an individual expression, it's very similar to the swarm, actually. It's an individual expression. At the same time, I wanted to form one whole. So we formed different groups, and different groups express themselves in different ways, but they always find this collective thread between their individuals. I think this is, to my opinion, a wonderful situation, that you can have individual people expressing themselves individually, at the same time, act collectively. Paintings, sculptures, this actually was design methods. So you don't see a lot of ICT in here, but the thinking is very close to the projects we do, where we do use the ICT, the CNC and the parametric. The thinking is very similar. Next project we did with a small group in the department with Odile, Sarah, Ahmed was in the group. Actually, the concept is very simple. I wanted to have a tower that adapts to changing circumstances and that acts itself as well. A tower as an actor. So you can only do this if all the components are actors themselves. So all the components, being the edges between the nodes, the flexible nodes in this case, are actors. Like the birds in this world, they're actors, they're acting their size, actually. So they're looking to their neighbors, they are synchronized with the movement of the neighbors, because if you want to move the tower, everyone has to move a little bit shorter, a little bit longer, etc. vibrates, pumps up itself, blesses its alive all the time, and responds to changing circumstances like direction of the wind. Next project is a project we did with Jasmine and Isona, and some artists from Fire Station as well, and with Najiba from the Qatar University. Maidan project, a monument actually for Kiev. We just missed it to get the first prize. This is basically where we started from, and this is how we made the interpretation of that. This is a monument for 100 heavenly heroes, basically the 100 people that died in the revolution. So each note, again, we have notes and edges, each note represents one of those heroes and their dynamic and network connection between those, because the real essence of that revolution was actually the network of active people that made it work. And it takes actually the shape of the flag, that's why we had a flag in the previous image. The waving movement, it was parametrically developed by Jasmin, and the 3D model by Najiba, and rendered by Diogo. We would embed the notes, these are quite big actually, the notes. We would embed them, perforate them, and embed them with LED lights, and we could program the whole thing to be the fire, for example, or to be something else that is an aspect of that monument. So contextuality has many different aspects. You don't take things literally. No, you take some mental images of what happened, and then you project it back using modern design technology, CNC construction methodologies, and ICT for the programming. This is the 3D print model. Next project, well, we have 12. I may end up well within time if I speed up like this. Next project, I really want to show this also. It's Architectural Day, 9th Architectural Day. Again, it's student work, and I made just this little sketch to organize it. So we found these wall elements, they were there stored somewhere. We thought, okay, why don't we use them and actually connect the student work, attach the student work to it. So models, we have colored fields as the backdrop for their renders and their drawings. And some information bar in the lowest regions. This is the setup. We had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We found 8 of them. And this is the arrangement actually to create a dynamic interior in the main hall of the Department of Architecture. And we have also the sculptures from design methods embedded. And number 15, interestingly enough, I asked the students to actually submit their portraits. Somehow, students at Qatar University are very good at drawing portraits. Someone has to tell me why this is. Faces, actually. And okay, you see portraits also of the emir and the father emir, but also other portraits mixed together. Surprisingly, after the show, they were removed for some reason. And I heard some reasons before, because then it may have not been appropriate. And I think it needs only a single person to complain that it's not appropriate, and then it's removed. Here you see an overview of the exhibition. You see how it works. It's perforated. You could navigate and wade through all the projects. You see the I selected many models because 3D is really the big thing that needs to be further developed. I attached the models in such a way that you could really look at it at the most attractive angle. Sometimes it's higher, sometimes it's lower, etc. It worked very well. And we included some of the paintings of earlier projects, the design methods. And What was good to see that students actually were developing skills in not just painting a surface, but actually making almost into a painting, a real painting, a serious painting. So it's not only a backdrop of that image to design, or it's actually almost a painting in itself. The one in the middle, exactly the same. And they were very happy to be on this wall element, which actually pictures the emirate and all the signatures that were actually collected here at Qatar University. And this fusion of own individual work and the nation, the person who represents the nation, actually was very well accepted. I think your work is in there, one of those. Yeah. Next project, it's not a project that I run here, but I still run my office in Rotterdam. This is an urban project, an urban design project, where I developed a design tool, a parametric design tool, actually to deal with the unforeseen, and actually to create the unforeseen, to create the unknown somehow. I introduced for this project also a concept called porosity. And I show you some images that give some sort of indication how we work with this. So this ball shape, which has the voxels, which represent the total program, 50,000 cubic meter, the total program in a most dense form. So it's everything. We can also, and that's the porosity tool that we developed in Grasshopper, Rhino Grasshopper, is to actually say, okay, but we don't use all of these positions of that first image you saw, we only use, say, 50% of those, creating a lot of voids, openings that you can start imagining what you can do with it. That you could, it actually triggers your imagination. So you don't know yet, but it might be something. It might be something interesting, an outdoor space or an unforeseen function, etc. We discussed this with project developers in Rotterdam, and they were highly interested in this because we basically were designing for the new citizen, the new nomadic system, citizen. Citizens that actually don't have a fixed place on Earth, but they travel, like Ali travels. 70 countries, 60 cities. This could be one of your places. I mean, the idea is also to have a new form of booking system, which I show in the next project. So this could be arranged in many ways. You could distribute the voxels, which is the cubic meters. We count and we do all sorts of calculations on this system. We know exactly what it is. We know exactly what we are doing. And even we have our estimations of what it could cost, because we are running a scheme in Grasshopper that not only analyzes the volumes and the geometry, but also analyzes possible building costs related to surface areas, the level of complexity, where it is positioned in the space, if it's something on the top, it just rests on something, it's cheaper, if it's down under, it's more expensive because it has to support all the others, etc. It's all in there. So we could talk with the project developer on many levels, many different levels. And the interesting thing is that it triggered them. It triggered them because we were not on the design level, actually, we were on one much more generic level. You have seen yesterday something like this, like a game. So it's becoming much closer to games. Game design, introduce all the stakeholders in that game to play that game and play with the parameters. This really works perfectly. So I think this is one of the strategies we should follow in architecture and urban design. Don't draw a finite plan, but actually create possibilities, create potential, and then include the others in the process. It becomes an inclusive process, a participatory process. Fatima used the same words, no? Participatory process. I think this is really important. No, you might like to see this image. But these These guys are the drivers. Behind everyone there are people who make things happen. So this at fire station, it was partly in combination with Qatar University, not so much the department, but more the College of Engineering. We worked with John, Khabibian, and the robotics department. And we did this robotic workshop, and here we are programming a vacuum cleaner. And then I show you what these vacuum cleaners are doing. They're tracing. Tracing, actually, a beautiful painting. A painting 10 meters long. We bought a canvas, the maximum size, 10 meters long, 2 meters wide. We stretched on the floor and we did the painting. So the robots were actually tracing along this whole stretch. That was one part of the project. Another part of the project was bringing the only robot that Qatar University has. Which is a robot that is so terribly slow. So the only thing it can do is actually pick up a thing and then, oops, a minute later drops it here again. So seeing that, I knew we really have to ask for more. So we applied equipment, new robots. I got an RRP grant for robotic printing. In that grant is also some amount to purchase robots. So hopefully we can do a much bigger step in this direction in the future. Besides, painting, which is an additive action, we also did subtractive. So we placed on the floor 10 meters again flour. We were looking for the most suitable material. So thinking about sugar or other things, so we chose flour to actually work with and to actually take it away by the robot. So here you see more of them in action, the painting robot and the flour robot. We simply use standard modes of operation of these robots, so you could have them drive circular and then you build into the boundaries and they make different patterns there, they move a little bit around and then they continue their trajectory. So the above painting we kept, the other painting has all lost. It's a temporary thing. You also see something out there, which is a robot. A drone, I think, you see flickering there. We also asked the students to work with drones, to play with them, to actually teach them to do tricks. So that was very interesting. Should do more of that. Next project. I use some older material actually, but it's an actual project. It's an internal brand I'm working on called Manic, which means multimodal accommodations for the nomadic international citizen. So we have the same subject coming up again. I imagined a place that is fully empty, completely no, nothing happens, and but it could be programmed in such a way that things popping up. So it becomes a sleeping room, it becomes your lounge area, it becomes your bathroom. So we have in an area of 50 square meters, actually we have the luxury of a large villa, but one after the other. So this is basically for a single person or two persons. But it's very interesting to see that in a much more condensed area, by programming it in the multimodal position, situation, you can actually create a luxury. And that's, I think, very promising for future applications. So we are talking to project developers here to see whether we can make something like this. It's also multimodality in that sense, because it can be programmed to be this and it can be programmed to be that. It's not necessarily a hotel room. It can be a temporary space to to have a dining, to have a dining table or a working area. It can be your art studio, it can be anything. So these colors represent the different functions here, not necessarily the light. And this happens over daytime and over nighttime, of course. We just chose a very simple structure to contain this. Actually, it's purely minimalist, but the maximalist part is in the programming. Programming is from home, from your computer, you do your booking. Programming is when you are there, okay? You can set all your atmospheres, all the modes you want to have it, so you can prepare in advance. That's the idea. So you are home, you are booking a space, and you're also booking the configuration. So you're not only saying, I booked a room as it is, no, you booked the configuration. So basically you book the way you want to use it. If you want to use it as an artist studio, might be completely up. Maybe you even pay less than you do that. But when you are there, you can still reconfigure. You can still say, oh no, I want it to be this in the next hour, I want it to be that. So I think this is a very powerful concept that really needs more attention, of course, working it out in more in detail. Another project, it's a much larger thing. It's a competition that was running and launched by Astral here. It's still not decided. It's still running as far as I know. They keep extending it and postponing it, but we didn't hear anything yet. So maybe it dies or maybe it doesn't. It's West Bay North Beach. Extension actually of North Beach area into something that contains a huge program, so it's ambitious as ever. And we decided actually to create artificial islands, then taking into consideration that sensitive area, because we have the palaces there of I think even the emir has palaces. So that sensitive area, we don't touch that, so we can add artificial islands there. And one of those actually is now the location also for our Studio 6 that we are running, so students are working on that. That's one thing, artificial islands. The other thing is connectivity. We wanted to connect that to the center of West Bay, and we found a concept for that in boardwalks, actually, inhabitable boardwalks, usable not only as a passage, but also as spaces. So from top down, it looks like this. We have big attractors here, which is one of my projects called the Qatar Wheel. It's a hotel combined with a Ferris wheel. Over there, we have another special feature. I don't elaborate on those, but I want to show you more. And a short video. You see the same porosity concept applied to the towers, but now filled in with functions we decided to have, like sky gardens and glazed exterior spaces. So the wheel is actually kept up by the hotel itself. So the support structure is integrated in the hotel. So here you see the spaciousness of those passages, so that they contain multiple functions. Shading structures, just like we saw before, based on solar studies. Where can we have the openings, where we have the closures. So basically the idea is that the connectivity is so huge that it will attract multiple functions, so that the center of the city center, actually, of West Spain, and this new part would be naturally connected to this activity. Here it looks quite empty, but imagine it to be active. Could be mesmerizing. Next project. It's an entry. We saw a previous entry of an Expo 2020 project. This is our entry. Done with a team in Holland again. Basically, it's the question here was to have the food, energy, water nexus represented in the building. So I just made this initial sketch. So we have these three trajectories, and somewhere they meet each other. Somewhere the food meets the energy, and the water meets the food, etc. That is the basis of the concept. For that concept, I imagined a sort of connectivity machine to support those multiple connections, basically consisting a building only consisting of slopes. Slopes and platforms, slope, platform, slope, platform. Oh. So it's like this structure you can stretch, and then it opens up like this this mesh panel. And then I imagine to have these trajectories unfolding in this project, meeting the others at crucial points, and developed it further into detail, into actually a structure that is based on a very radical approach of one building, one detail. So the whole building, really literally everything, consists of only one basic component, whether it's a floor, a wall, or anything else. Everything is parametrically controlled, also the transitions between open and closed, and the slopes, etc. It's all controlled according to values that actually comply with local rules. So believe it or not, but it complies with local rules. It's calculated, so we also know that this can stand, actually, and we also know what it costs. I know exactly what it costs. It's 3,000 square meter surface area, and it will cost 5,500 million euros. So about 20 million Qatari. That is for the building itself, complete, including installation. Then you make a cutting, which is basically the cutting of a 3D model. It looks bizarre. Have you ever seen a cutting out of the National Museum, how that looks? You cannot make any sense out of it. Same as this, because it's so three-dimensionally developed that sections like floor plans and vertical section, they don't really make sense. You cannot understand the building by reading plans. You can only understand it by going into it. Make renders, maybe. You have spaces like these, you have a nice carpet, and make a movie how you navigate through it. Deeper, we just embed up some stairs at the side of the slope itself. You can walk both, basically. We've seen images of Kas this morning, and we've seen images of these very natural grown, natural developed structures, and somehow this is very close to this. And you can navigate, like you would be able to navigate in Venice, you simply use your Google Maps, or you use your navigator. You never lost the lose track of where you are. This is the central area, which is a big waterfall, and the oasis, basically. So basically, we pumped up the interior. Fire station, many of you have seen this, it's the Little Babylon project that for some reason doesn't really go up outside here. And that is because there is, I don't know exactly the reason, but probably it's that the voltage or the power is not sufficient, because it's exactly the same as what was set up there, but somehow it behaves differently. So the idea is, it was explained by Rolf yesterday. We designed the shape, and they actually designed the interactivity. And the idea was, okay, you send your tweets, I repeat it quickly, you send your tweets, the sculpture repeats the tweet, but also interprets the tweet in such a way that it finds certain words in what you are twittering, finds certain words, compares it with a small database of a number of words. If there is a relation between that word you have, Twitter, and that database, then it finds the mood that's actually connected to that word. So the mood could be excited, could be quiet, etc. So these are the emotions that were mapped to this sculpture. It doesn't really work very well in the colors, but the colors come now from the fountain. So that was the nice thing about this location. Well covered in the press. I cannot read it. Probably just says that there is something like Little Babylon. Next project, students again. So I asked the students, here we have this vacuum cleaner again, this robot. I asked the students, take things apart into their smallest details as to understand how it works. And describe the parts, and then paint the parts, draw the parts as if you are the designer of the part. So if you were a designer, how would you actually design that part that matches, and that connects to the other parts? It's about the connection from one part to the other. It's always about connectivity. Connectivity between the smallest parts, really. Again, birds in a swarm, no? Smallest actors, they communicate with their neighbors. Only their immediate neighbors, actually. So if you have one part, look at the immediate neighboring part. That was the task. They did very well, actually. Also, I asked them to look at cars. They are designers, so you look at bigger things. I asked them to look at vintage cars, and this is early 60s cars aboard Thunderbird. It's in the FBQ Museum. You probably know that they have this huge collection of cars. So we went there. They all chose their parts, and I asked them, describe how this part relates to the grille, to the bumper, the fender, the hood, etc. The decoration strip, how does it relate to each other? That's the important thing. It's not only shape from the outside. They did their job. They did it quite well. They are painting first year students that I'm talking about. First year, they don't know nothing about cars. Really, they hated cars practically. But before the project, now they love cars. Because I teach them to look differently at things. Not only just something like a car and they all look alike. No, they are not alike. They're all completely different. Even the most common designs, even if it's a Nissan or a Toyota, they are completely different in many aspects, and also in many aspects the same. So it's important to look at these differences, look more in detail. So naturally they chose this older car, but then I asked them to look at modern cars as well. BMW. Well, this is an amazing design. This is my picture, it's not one of those. Students did work, did their work. And one did a very interesting interpretation. She said, I'm going to use the remote control because this is my idea of a modern car. Basically, I think design studios is about creating situations that students can have, can learn and have a lot of fun at the same time. I asked them to look at the modern car and actually take one component and then model it, 3D model it, yeah, with their hands. And surprisingly, I didn't expect that. Not only this student, but many students took the Lexus grill, which is bizarre. It's a bizarre grill. I don't know if you know the car, but it's over the top. Interesting. But this student did quite well. It's very three-dimensional, the grill, and he managed to look at that. Then I asked them to do a piece of topic art. Oh, there you see the grill again. And you see the remote-controlled car. I asked them to start from the components and make a piece of public art that consists of components that are not the same. So not repeating the same component, but same family, but different. So like the cars, they look the same, but they're all different. They're all cars. Similar to a building component, or like the Expo 2020 pavilion that I showed. It's all the triangles, but they're all different. So that's the idea of parametric design. So you don't need to use computers to actually get that idea across. You can work also in analog ways. And that is very, comes very close actually to what the Kirpichevs has shown us yesterday, Lou and Vlad. And we can teach the kids that are 20 or 21, we can teach the kids to feel young and to express themselves more intuitively. I think that's important. So there was a discussion yesterday, also Marcos instigated that discussion. We can do similar things at the university and still be very serious about what we are doing. So it's not just leisure or playtime, no. You teach very explicit things. At the same time, you give them the freedom to express. It's another project, circles, they're all different. This is a very planetary project by one of the first year students. And it's one of my guests in the juries. Another approach using triangles in different ways, one jutting out completely. We discussed, of course, that support structure here, because I was extremely opposed to that, because the triangle has to do the work and not the support structure. And she was able to adjust the project later. Successfully. Qatari students, especially the Qatari students, are very political. So when asking them to do a public art project, at least five or six of them chose this very political stance. So Qatar. Okay, you see there? The white thing coming out of the rocks, it's the fist out of the box. This is the contour of Qatar and the multifaceted, the diversification basically of Qatar, which we are in the diversification era, the diversification of Qatar economy. That one is also a very abstracted contour of Qatar, that's the right color, I think, and it's this web of interconnections between the people that is actually caused or actually stimulated by the blockade. So the blockade has very many positive effects on the minds of Qatar, I can see. And some of it is political, some of it is non-political, but still taking advantage of a sort of new freedom of thinking. So she chose just blocks of different sizes. And then in the end of the project, I asked them, what if this public art piece was interactive? What would you do? And she had the guts to think, okay, it's a climbing tower. So I use these elements to climb up, and it becomes a climbing tower. A very challenging one, as I have to say, but it's interesting to hear this from a student. I think she was Qatari, if I remember. You wouldn't think that. How many minutes? Can I finish with this one? This is the last question. It's almost an invitation to come to Sheikh Faisal Museum. There's this exhibition of Jasmine Ilona. This is Ilona's work. It's an invitation of Mondrian. So I showed a lot of artwork, architecture work. But as I said in the beginning, we work together almost in everything, whether it's art or architecture. And that's, I think, the important thing here. You're not an architect as regimented as that. So you work with other disciplines. We can work with robotics, we can work with artists. You work with the engineers, and that's more traditional, of course. But you work with a different flock of people actually interacting with each other. Carpets, and that's why I showed this actually, because these carpets are made in Qatar. When we are